Last week we wrapped up a little three-part series we were doing called The Wavemaker, where we talked about the ways that Jesus just sort of created controversy by introducing the kingdom of God. He's not going out there and trying to be confrontational in these instances, but he's catching some static from different people all over the place regardless. Earlier in the year, actually I'm jumping ahead of myself here, so this week what we're going to do is just a little one-week thing I'm calling No Problem. Here's the thing, is that there are three rapid-fire stories, or like little chunks that Matthew gives us about faith. And really what they're showing here, one of the many things they're showing, but sort of primarily here, is that there is nothing that is too difficult for Jesus. There is nothing that is a problem for him. There is nothing that he can't do. There is nothing that is too hard. What's interesting is earlier in the year, we had a little series called The Untouchables, right? Where we looked at Jesus reaching out to these different people groups that were controversial for different ways. How he reaches out to a leper, and then he reaches out to a Gentile, and then he reaches out to a woman. He sort of breaks down these barriers that had been set up along the way. He's going to the most downtrodden, the most outcast. And what was happening there was that he's going in those instances to the people that no one else would. This morning, he's going to help out the people that no one else could. And so these miracles are sort of written in this short, quick succession by Matthew. Again, just like some of the other stories we've looked at, it's funny. Matthew's one of the longest books, but he writes these stories the shortest. And so he just kind of gives us this boom, 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 boom. And so we're going to cover them pretty quick here this morning, help you get a feel for that and see what he's trying to show us here. So we'll start in verse 18. Says this, while he was saying these things, behold, Matthew's word for, hey, look out, pay attention. While he was saying these things to them, behold, a ruler came in and knelt before him, saying, my daughter has just died, but come and lay your hand on her and she will live. And Jesus rose and followed him with his disciples. And behold, a woman who had suffered from a discharge of blood for 12 years came up behind him and touched the fringe of his garment. For she said to herself, if I only touch his garment, I will be made well. Jesus turned, and seeing her, he said, take heart, daughter, your faith has made you well. And instantly, the woman was made well. And when Jesus came to the ruler's house and saw the flute players and the crowd making a commotion, he said, go away, for the girl is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed at him. But when the crowd had been put outside, he went in and took her by the hand, and the girl arose. And the report of this went all throughout all that district. And so Jesus has just finished talking about fasting. That's what we covered last week, where he gives some instruction on that. And Matthew picks this story up immediately afterwards. As a matter of fact, it's during the meal, right? It says while he was saying these things to them. So he's in the middle of telling them about, remember, old wine, new wineskins, old wineskins, all that stuff. He's talking about all that, and this guy walks in, and he's a ruler. And he comes in, and he kneels before Jesus. And one of the things that's interesting here is it shows us that Jesus doesn't respond only to the poor, but he responds to the powerful as well. Because we've seen story after story of Jesus responding to the poor, responding to the downtrodden, and so on. And he does that. But he also responds to this guy, which I think is heartening. Because look, there are some people that come to Lakeside that do pretty well for themselves. But if we think about it globally, if you make $10,000 a year, you are in the top 16% in the world. And so we are all rich. If you have that global perspective and you think about people all around the world, we have more than the vast majority of them. And so it's heartening for us to see that, yes, Jesus responds to us too. He truly comes and responds to anyone that calls on him. And so this guy comes in and he kneels before Jesus. So he has this posture of worship and he says the most incredible thing. "My daughter has died, but come and lay your hand on her, and she will live." My daughter has died, but... Like, what incredible faith this shows. Because, but Jesus is unbeatable. You can't top it. It doesn't matter what you put in front of that. It doesn't stand a chance. It is the clause that makes anything that comes before it okay. This happened, but Jesus. When you have something like that that explains away the first part's not so scary. I remember there was one time we had just sold our house in D.C. and we were doing taxes and things like that, our first tax season when we were here. And I get, and Adrian and I will G-chat and stuff throughout the day. I get a G-chat that's like, "So we owe the government like $20-some thousand. And I was like, "Wait, what?" Come to find out, like, yeah, and we still have that from when we sold the house, and she had planned all of this, but she didn't lead with that. She led with, "We owe the government $20-some thousand. I was like, "What?" But there was the, "But, yeah, I know this, and we've planned for this, and it's okay. It's not a problem." See, that you needed the "but" afterwards to make that first part okay. But Jesus makes anything that comes before it okay. It's like you're playing poker and you're sitting on a royal flush. It doesn't matter what you've got. I win. Go all in. Please do. I lost my job, but Jesus. My health is failing, but Jesus. My daughter has died, but Jesus. And so who is this guy that's got this faith like this? Well, best we can discern, he was probably a leader in the synagogue, the way Matthew talks about him, which is interesting because if you're familiar, those guys hated Jesus. They considered Jesus this dangerous heretic. And so how desperate must this guy have been? Like, how many other options did he exhaust before he comes to Jesus? How much money did he spend on different cures? How much did he try before it got to where his daughter was dying and he just had nowhere else to turn but to Jesus? And the response that he gets from Jesus is incredible. It says that Jesus rose and followed him. This is the only time in all of Scripture that it says that Jesus follows anyone. We see all the time the disciples, they get up and follow Jesus. We just looked at a couple weeks ago. He sees Matthew, and Matthew's collecting taxes, and he just goes, "Hey, Matthew, follow me." And Matthew goes, "Okay," and Matthew follows Jesus. We never see Jesus follow anyone else except for here. This is the only time that happens. And so what I think Matthew's showing us here is that, make no mistake about it, where faith appears, Jesus follows. And so they leave, and while they're on the way, he gets interrupted by another woman. She has a bleeding issue that's gone on for 12 years. And you've probably heard this before if you've been in church for a while. And it's true that what we're likely talking about here is some sort of like chronic menstrual problem that she's had for 12 years. Now, that's not just a random piece of knowledge to just throw out. That actually plays an important role here. Because you see, according to the law, whenever someone was bleeding, they were unclean, and everything they touched were unclean. And there's specific things in the law about menstruation in this way. It's specifically called out as, when this happens, you're unclean for this amount of time, and then you do this, and then you're not unclean. And so this means that this woman had been ceremonially unclean for 12 years. So for 12 years, if she touched anybody, they were unclean. For 12 years, anything that she touched became unclean. This is a horrible way to live. She couldn't touch anyone. She couldn't touch anything. She was this outcast. And so she sort of formulates this plan. She's going to be sneaky, and if she can just touch Jesus, she's good. She'll be healed. And so we get to see here how desperate she is here. Because remember, anyone that she touches, they're unclean after she touches them. And so if she touches Jesus' coat is going to be made unclean. But she's just got to do something. So she's thinking, well, maybe if I just touch his coat, I just kind of do it in the crowd, no one sees it, then No one will be any of the wiser. It'll be all good. Now, the fringe here that Matthew's talking about is probably one of the four tassels that were worn according to the law. If she can just touch one of those tassels, they're the same tassels that later Jesus will tell the Pharisees, like, look, you just like to have long tassels. Everybody sees your tassels. Look, just you have normal tassels. What's wrong? Right? And so she's got to get one of those. And that's her point of faith, that if she can just touch one of those tassels, then she's going to be made whole. Now, it seems kind of superstitious, right? Like, I wouldn't prescribe this to anyone. This doesn't set some sort of, like, biblical principle for tassel touching or something. That we're going to have a tassel touching service, and if you need healing, come in and we'll put up, I'll wear a robe and y'all can grab it. Like, that's not what's happening here. But what's interesting is that Jesus honors her imperfect faith here, which I think says a lot about him. He doesn't wait for her to have everything figured out. He doesn't wait for her to have perfect theology. She comes to him in faith and he honors that. And so she's successful in this plan, right? She gets on through the crowd, she touches his coat, and Jesus doesn't let her just slink away. That part of the plan blows up. He whips around and sees her. And instead of just letting her slink away, he rewards her faith and heals her. Remember, it's not the touch that heals her. It's when Jesus turns around and says, "Have courage, take heart, your faith has made you well." He rewards her faith with this healing. He does it in front of everybody. Now, it's important that he does it in front of everybody, right? Because she's been unclean for so long. And so if he doesn't proclaim this where everybody can hear it, he's fixing the physical part, but he's not fixing the social part for her that's broken. And so holistically, Jesus goes, we're going to restore you, not just physically, but we're going to restore you to community with everybody as well. And so now everybody knows she's clean. Now she can be involved back in the community. And there's just this little blurb that Matthew doesn't spend much time on, and then we move on. We keep moving. And we get to the ruler's house, and there's all of this commotion. Now, we talked a little bit about funerals a couple weeks back and how they happen the same day as the death. Now, there was another funeral tradition that I had researched that was really interesting, but I had to cut out of the message because it just didn't serve a purpose at all. Well, today it does. So, I think it's interesting. Maybe you won't, but we'll see. So, back in this culture, they had professional mourners. That was a job. Like, you just go to funerals and be sad. And you got paid to do that, right? Like, and I thought, YouTube celebrities were weird, right? And so they had musicians that you would pay to play while people mourned. They had mostly women who would come and wail and lead what one commentator called sad clapping. I don't know what that means. Is it like the opposite of a slow clap? Like you start fast and then get, I don't know. They're like cheerleaders for sadness, basically. And it wasn't just some fringe thing that was like, oh, it's this luxury. No, in the Mishnah, it talks about how even the poorest family should have at least two flute players and one wailer at your funeral. So Adrian and I have been joking about this since that message a few weeks ago. Like, think of my funeral, I want a couple flautists, right? Play like a wrestling entrance theme is like a kind of... And so, I mean, this is super weird to us, right? This sounds like some kind of like Kim Jong-il kind of thing, where people are paid to be sad here. But it explains something, though, because what happens when Jesus goes, she's not dead, she's asleep? They immediately start laughing at him, because they're not very sincere with this mourning. They're just paid to be there. You want to pay me to be sad? I'll come be sad. And when some guy says something wild, I'm going to laugh at him, right? And so Jesus gets there and he kicks everybody out. Now you'd think that he'd want all of them to watch this happen, right? Isn't that the point? Isn't that why Jesus is doing these miracles, so that everybody sees him and believes? But he doesn't want them to see it. See, Jesus isn't doing miracles for show. He does them for people, for needs. Like, this is just normal to him. This is what the kingdom of God looks like. These things just happen. And so I also wonder if we're getting here an illustration of that pearls before swine principle, where Jesus says, don't throw your pearls before swine, don't give to dogs what is holy. He's like, these people aren't worthy of seeing what I'm about to do right now. So he boots them out. And then the miracle that happens is insane. He raises this girl from the dead. He says she's just sleeping, and that makes everybody laugh. But to Jesus, that's all it is. It's sleeping. That's how easy it is for Jesus to raise the dead. It's like waking somebody up. And now make no mistake about it. Like, Jesus doesn't say, oh, she's only sleeping because they've misdiagnosed her. This is not the story of Jesus waking a girl up from a nap, right? This is the story of Jesus going in, confronting death, and for him, it's just as easy as going, hey, get up. This death, it might as well just be sleep to Jesus. That's how toothless it is to him. And so we see this all throughout the New Testament, where they refer to death, but they just call it sleep. It happens 17 times in the New Testament, where they use sleep to just talk about death. Because what Jesus is showing here is that he can conquer anything. He can even conquer death. There's nothing that he cannot overcome if he can overcome death. No one's ever said, like, oh, I was dead, but I got better. There is nothing he cannot do. He is supreme over everything. And what's incredible is that because Jesus then later will die and rise from the dead, we get to share in this. We get to conquer death with him. We get to experience resurrection when we put our faith in him. This is what Paul talks about in Philippians 3, that I may know him in the power of his resurrection and may share in his sufferings, becoming like him in his death, that by any means possible I may attain the resurrection from the dead. When we're in Christ, when we have our faith in Jesus, we may share in his sufferings, we may share in his death, but when we do, we will also share in his resurrection. The early church wrote about this more than almost anything else. Victory over death was one of their most prominent themes. It was victory over death and loving your enemy. Those were like the two things they write about constantly. I think we would do well to return to that more often. Because with this, because of Jesus, death is no longer to be feared. That's why Paul's able to say something like, to live is Christ, to die is gain. Right? Like, to die, that's good for me. It's a benefit if that happens. Until it does, I've got Jesus. But when I die, I get more Jesus. What can you do to me? Jesus tosses fear out. It's removed from the Christian vocabulary. Why are you going to be afraid of death? Like, don't you know I've conquered that? It's defeated. It's got no teeth no more. Death, where is your sting? It's gone. He's in control. He has conquered all, and we can trust him. And then Matthew keeps going. It says, and as Jesus passed on from there, two blind men followed him, crying aloud, have mercy on us, son of David. But when he entered the house, the blind men came to him, and Jesus said to them, do you believe that I am able to do this? They said to him, yes, Lord. And he touched their eyes, saying, according to your faith, be it done to you. And their eyes were open, and Jesus sternly warned them, see that no one knows about it. But they went away and spread his fame through all the district. So Jesus moves on from there. So he's just risen this girl from the dead. And he moves on from there, and all of a sudden, these two blind guys start following him around and yelling at him. They're yelling out, and they're calling him Son of David, which was this title that was understood for the Messiah. It was widely known, widely used back then. These guys are the first ones in the Gospels to use it for Jesus, which is kind of interesting, if you think about it, right? Two blind men are the first ones to see Jesus for who he truly is. They've not seen any of the miracles that he's done because they're blind, right? They didn't see him just raise a girl from the dead. Maybe they heard it. But they believe and they're convinced. And so they start following Jesus and they follow him until they have him cornered. Which admittedly, it's not easy for a blind person to do. Right? Like they weren't daredevil. They didn't have like special senses for this. They follow him. It's impressive. I'm impressed by these guys. Now there's also, it kind of seems a little mean on Jesus' part, right? Like he's just kind of leading these blind guys around through the streets. Like it seems, it's almost like he's messing with them or something. But they're determined. They're not going to go without getting to Jesus. And so they follow him. And I think what's going on here is that Jesus doesn't want people to hear them calling him the Son of David. Because they're calling to him as Messiah. And Jesus is trying to downplay that at this point in his ministry. We see this at the end of this paragraph, right? Because Messiah for the Israelites was as much a political term as it was a spiritual term. We hear Messiah now and we just think like, oh, Jesus died for our sins. We don't think about sort of the political side that they had in mind, which was Messiah means, oh, overthrowing Rome, taking back our land, forming a new kingdom on earth here, getting our oppressors off our back. But Jesus isn't going to do that. And he's not ready for his ministry to end, so he doesn't want all this Messiah talk going out there. Even if it's true, he doesn't want that being broadcast yet. Time's not right. So Jesus leads them into a house, and then he asks them a question. Do you believe that I am able to do this? Which, if any one sentence is going to, that one sums up the message this morning. Do you believe that I am able to do this? Doesn't matter what this is, that's the question that Jesus poses to all of us. Do you believe that I am able to do this? And they respond simply, yes, Lord. It's a statement of faith in what Jesus can do and who he is all at the same time, right? Yes, we believe that you can do this and you are Lord. It's essentially an amen. Amen literally means this is true. Verily or truly. It's a yes, Lord. So every time we pray, amen, we're saying, yes, Lord, I believe that you can do this. So Jesus hears this response and he reaches out and he touches them and heals them. Now, eye diseases back then were gnarly. You did not want to be touching someone's eye disease. I mean, you don't now, but much less someone has pink eye, you're like, But back then, like, they were gross. And nevertheless, Jesus reaches out and touches their eyes. It's another incredible display of compassion from Jesus that he is unafraid to touch our deepest messes. He reaches out and he touches them and then he tells them that according to their faith, they are healed. Now, it's important here to note that he's not saying you have so much faith that it has achieved for you this healing. That's not what he's saying. What he's saying is you have faith and because that faith exists, you are healed. It's not a measure of how much, it's a measure of whether or not it exists at all. Because there is faith, you are healed. And where there is faith, there is Jesus. The author of Hebrews says, and without faith, it is impossible to please him. For whoever would draw near to God must believe that he exists and that he rewards those who seek him. There is nothing that Jesus loves more than to be trusted. For us to believe that he is able, that honors him greatly. In fact, without it, the writers of Hebrews says it's impossible to please him without it. And so Jesus heals them, and then he does something even more surprising. He tells them to be quiet. Don't say anything to anybody about this. It's kind of weird, right? And I think what he's trying to do here is, again, sort of distance himself from that Messiah talk. Like, let's not speed up this here. I still got some things I'm trying to do. And so these guys, they must think that Jesus is trying to be modest or something, right? Because they don't obey this direct command from Jesus. Oh, the danger of ignoring the commands of God because we know better. I can't tell you how many times I run into that mentality. that, well, we've got it figured out, and so, yeah, Scripture says this, but we know better, so we'll just do this instead. Here's the thing, is that trusting God means trusting His commands, even if we may think they're wrong. Here's the thing, if you've got a concept of God that just so happens to never disagree with you, there's a good chance you're not worshiping God, you're worshiping an idealized version of yourself. Because there's all kinds of things that I read the Bible and I see and I go, that's not how I'd do it. I mean, for example, I got dragged kicking and screaming into a Christian nonviolent perspective because that's not my personality whatsoever. Like, you do something that upsets me, especially like you yell at my wife or something, you're going to catch these hands, right? The problem, though, is Jesus. I can't ignore His commands. And what happens is at first I read something like this and I bristle. I'm like, ugh, I don't like that. But then slowly over time, I begin to see the beauty in it. It's a process. But what that process means is that God is still working on my heart and on my mind. We run into a whole heap of trouble when we think that we can understand God better apart from His Word than with it. That temptation is so rampant today, and I see it bringing down so many people. And unfortunately, these blind men, they fall into it. They're such an incredible, incredible example of faith. And then they totally flunk on being an example of obedience. See, obedience has to accompany faith, and it's not automatic. You don't just put your trust in Jesus and then wake up the next day and you're perfect. I wish. But instead, it looks like dying every day to yourself, picking up your cross and following Him, deciding every day that you're going to follow Jesus, that you're going to live His commands. You're never going to get it perfect, of course not. But every single day you're picking up that cross and you're doing your best every time. But Matthew keeps going here. He says, as they were going away, behold, a demon-oppressed man who was mute was brought to Him. And when the demon had been cast out, the mute man spoke. And the crowds marveled, saying, never was anything like this seen in Israel. But the Pharisees said, he casts out demons by the prince of demons. Now this last vignette, even for Matthew, is very brief, right? The real focus of it isn't even the healing that happens here. He's like, yeah, so there's this demon-oppressed guy, came in, Jesus was like, be healed, he was healed. That's it. Like, that's all he gives you. He gives you nothing. There's no window dressing here. He's not trying to build a story, just the facts, right? But the focus is, here, the division that this miracle creates. We saw desperate faith with the ruler and with the woman, that they were desperate to get to Jesus. They were desperate to do something about their condition, that they knew that He could help, and they had faith that if they just got to Him, He would make the difference. They had desperate faith. We see the blind men who have this faith that will pursue Jesus no matter what. They're blind guys chasing a rabbi through the streets, but they're going to do it because they're going to get to Jesus, and nothing's going to stop them. So we see desperate faith. We see pursuing faith. And now Matthew turns to his reader, goes, and what about you? What about your faith? How are you going to respond? Are you going to respond to this Jesus like the crowd does, or are you going to respond to this Jesus like the Pharisees? The Pharisees see this and they just can't accept it, right? Because they're so convinced that they are right, that they can't see what Jesus is doing right in front of them. They knew they were right. So if something came along that contradicted that, well, it just had to be wrong. Even if you have to make the insane leap that, oh, well, there's this guy that's demon-possessed, and so he's casting out other demons. That doesn't make any sense. We read that now and we're like, that doesn't make any sense. There must be some culture. No, it didn't make sense back then either. They're just grasping at straws at this point. It's like confirmation bias run amok. Like, it makes no sense. If only these guys had entertained the fact that maybe we're the ones who are wrong. It's a good question to ask yourself every once in a while. And so this last story here, it serves as a challenge to us. How will you respond? So the overarching message of these three events is faith, right? And we learn a lot about it from these examples here. For one, faith trusts Jesus with real life. Faith is not an abstract belief in a higher power. Faith isn't a, oh yeah, I believe in Jesus. Sure, yeah. There's more to it than that. I remember once I was in a counseling session and I asked someone why they thought they were a Christian. And you would have thought I asked them, like, how do you sequence the human genome? They just, no answer. They had no concept. They had no idea that it was more than saying, yeah, sure, Jesus is a thing. Like, they thought that was it. That was enough. And it's not. That's not enough. Faith in Jesus looks like trust in Jesus. It looks like obedience to Jesus. So you can't say like, oh yeah, sure, I believe in God, and that's enough. No, that's not faith. You can't say like, well, I've taught in Sunday school, and I've done this, and if you start listing, if I ask you, why are you a Christian, and you start listing a list of accomplishments, you don't get it. Because it's not about what you do, it's about what Jesus has done, and your trust and your faith in Him. That by faith, you receive His grace and His salvation. And so faith brings real life issues to Jesus. Faith trusts Him. So often we live like Christian atheists, right? Where we say that, yeah, we believe that God exists, but then we live our lives completely like He does not. I don't just mean that in terms of obedience, which we kind of talked about, but that's certainly part of it. But I mean, bringing our real issues to Him. If we believe that we serve the Creator of the universe who loves us and wants to give His children good gifts, why would we not bring our needs to Him? And so these stories show us that we don't have this reluctant listener up there. We have an eager Savior who wants to listen to us, who wants to help us. When we bring Him our needs, He is ready and willing to help. Faith comes to Jesus in need, believing He can make a difference. Faith also pursues Jesus no matter what. Think back of some of the miracle stories we've covered in this chapter, right? Faith tears the roof off to get to Jesus. Faith presses through the crowds. Faith ignores a death, believing it is never too late. Faith throws out any sort of propriety and just chases after Him. Faith says, I'm going to touch Jesus no matter what it takes, no matter what obstacle is there. I'm going through it. I'm in it to win it. Sometimes He doesn't give an answer right away. Sometimes He feels far off. But faith doesn't give up. Faith presses on. Faith trusts Him. Faith follows Jesus into the house when it doesn't get an answer in the street. And so I want to end the same place this morning that Matthew ends. What about you? Where will you place your faith? Will you place your trust in Jesus, that He died and rose again for your sins and has extended this free gift of salvation to you? Will you pursue Him and chase after Him and let nothing stop you? Will you pair that faith with obedience? Will you dig into His Word and learn to delight in His commands, to begin to walk as He walked and allow the Holy Spirit to transform you to be more like Him? There's a very simple sentence here that Matthew uses to describe the blind men. He says this, and their eyes were open. And the all-important question this morning is, are yours? Let's pray. Lord, we thank You that we serve a God who is willing and able to hear our cries and our prayers and is enthusiastic about intervening, that loves to give good gifts to his children. We thank you for that. God, I pray that you would build faith in all of us, that we would learn to trust you and serve you, that we would bring real life to you, that we would put our confidence and our trust in you and in you alone. And we thank you in Jesus' name. Amen.